Hey, it's not Sunday.
Maybe it is somewhere in the world.
Sunday, yeah. Somewhere in the universe.
Clocked.
Yeah, it's Martian Sunday. Happy Martian Sunday!
I've been trying to wrap my head around the whole, because Mars has almost got the same day as us. It's like 24 hours and like 40 minutes. I'm like, yeah, same as? Not quite. So do you have do we add up once a month, or every 2 months or something, have every 40 days have Mars Day or something like that for Mars people to catch up?
In the Kim Stanley Robinson Mars trilogy, they had at midnight every night, they would have the time slip, which was 23 minutes that the clocks all just froze. So it was a free extra time, which works for the day to day. But as the calendars don't sync up, you would have to do a leap day you could probably just make a Martian calendar where it's Martian calendar only has 28 days and then suddenly jumps to the next month or whatever.
Yeah, it's where it gets tricky. It's easy. The day part's easy, but that's the whole Brian, you're on Mars, I'm on Earth, right?
Sure.
I'm like, hey, Brian, that was a really cool motocross video you made, by the way. That was really cool. we're gonna post that. We're gonna post that on October 30th.
That's Sol 250. Saw around Sol 250 then. Got it. Okay.
I know. Our team will get on it. All right. Thanks. Yeah. Hey, Brian, where were you? We needed you to do some social media push for your Mars.
I thought it was Sol 250. Is it not? Oh, no, wait. I forgot about, you're on the Pacific Theater because it's World War II.
But seriously, dude, that was a rad motorcycle jump.
Yeah. Don't thank me. Thank gravity.
Or the lack thereof.
All right. Go here. Got my notes. Cool. All righty, guys. I think I'm ready if you are. But only if you are.
I'm ready. I'm ready.
Alrighty. Well, take it away in 3, 2.
Welcome to the Weird Things Podcast. I'm Adrian Maine, joined by Brian Brushwood.
BRB, going to Mars to do some sweet jumps on my motorcycle.
And all the way back from jolly old England, and now he's got a posh accent, Justin Robert Young.
Well, righto, captains.
You know, all it took was Madonna, one layover in Heathrow, and she had an English accent.
By the way, did I hear this right? At some point, I read in some article that in the American colonies, they spoke very close to how we speak today. But then over in England, to distinguish themselves from those filthy working class American colonists, they fancied up their language. And so what we think of as a British accent was a manufactured thing that started in the aristocracy and then made its way down as fashion trends tend to do.
I've heard the first half that American English is probably closer to what was spoken years ago. And it is interesting I've been reading a lot of stuff 19th century historical fiction, which is, certainly probably closer to now than some of the earlier periods of time. But some of it, you read the works of Benjamin Franklin, and that guy was talking our language. And then you notice there is this sort of elevated writing that came about at some point, which is curious because I would say Jules Verne was writing before H.G. Wells, but his English translations of his stuff is actually an easier read than H.G. Wells.
Huh. Crazy.
So, who knows? But hey, we're not here to talk about that. We're here to talk about weird things. But before we go off on to really, really weird stuff, I want to ask you guys a question. Who's feeling a little bit adventurous? Justin, you just went to England, right?
I did, yeah. The capital of adventure.
Brian, you ride a bike, mountain bike, you eat fire.
Pina coladas and getting caught in the rain. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm giving it all up. I'm becoming a shut-in. I've decided that even the sun is too dangerous. Do you realize how much radiation? That's a nuclear radiation when you walk outside.
I got a little fun side story I can bring up about that regarding some interesting research.
Sure.
One of the things exciting about doing space research is finding out all the different potential things that can be done in low Earth orbit, exposure to, you know, radiation, et cetera. And they found some researchers actually put some fungus into, were able to grow some on board, I think, the ISS in a contained environment and brought it back. And they noticed that it had what may have been, you know, an enhanced ability or resistance for radiation and stuff. It, you know, could be another pathway towards
interesting
finding, you know, resistance for that. But that's not what I'm here to talk about. Brian, do you like to scuba, right?
Yeah, no, I've been scuba. In fact, I was gonna learn how to scuba with my 12-year-old. We were gonna take classes together.
That's cool. Get on the scoops. Was we like to say we were certifiable together. Justin, you ever scuba dived?
I was very briefly PADI certified.
By the way, allegedly, and somebody can verify this on the internet, but allegedly the guy who created the scuba apparatus, because it's a self-contained underwater breathing apparatus, he insists on, kind of like the guy who made GIFs, insists on pronouncing it GIF, even though it's a graphics interchange file. This was the reverse. This guy insisted it's Scubba, even though everyone wants to say scuba.
You know, even Linus Torvald kind of gave up on that one.
He's like, fine, it's Linux, whatever. Yeah, great. I mean, it's on my name, whatever.
Yeah, I'm looking up the just the history of that. You got me going down a rabbit hole. I thought Jacques Cousteau invented anything to deal with underwater, him and Aquaman. So any of you guys ever gone on a shark dive?
I've seen a shark on a dive. As a matter of fact, there was a we were in spring break. Let me take you on a trip. Spring break 95. I'm sitting there swimming.
Best word, Homer Simpson, high school age hair.
Yes,
you know.
Exactly. Down at not Cozumel, Cancun. There are two things I remember most about that dive. Number one is the water was so clear that the moment you jump in, you just see yourself as being suspended 30 feet up in the air. Like I got vertigo and the pit dropped out of my stomach because I thought I was falling to my death. And then we went down and started swimming around, and the guide points off to there's like a shelf, you know, and he points to the left under the shelf where I kind of see something moving, and he points to the right on the shelf and I kind of see something moving, and I get a little bit closer, and I realize the two things I'm seeing moving are the head and tail of a nurse shark that's hidden underneath there, and I'm like 5 feet away, and it was just like whoop, nope, nope, nope.
Dude, that was same. My first dive ever, and it was one of the things I asked the dive instructor. Like, I knew a lot about sharks, but I'm like, what are the chances we'll see a shark? Like, your chances are, like, your first dive just is it. You're not going to see a shark. I'm like, okay. Dive off the boat. Bubbles clear. And what do I see? It was about 20 feet away.
Just
nurse shark.
Immediately.
Oh, very first thing. And that's like, I have a weird relationship with animals. Like when I was doing my TV show, we had, you know, I had to do a thing with like a scorpion, a snake, and I forget something else. And I'm like, hey, what does it feel like when the scorpion's claws bite you? And they're like, it won't bite you. I'm like, yeah, but just tell me so I'll know. He's like, it'll be like pliers. I'm like, okay, because it's going to claw me. He's like, dude, it's not. I'm like, no, it will. Snake, what will that be like? Oh, a couple little tiny pinpricks. Okay. It's like, dude, they never bother me. I'm like, it will. They will. And they both of them, the scorpion went up, clenched my finger. You know, he showed me how to get it off. The snake, the same thing. It was just like, you know, whatever animal encounter I'm going to have.
That's Could amazing.
Have. So, gentlemen, so you guys up for maybe hopping in like a shark cage, you know, and maybe doing a little shark dive?
Well, I mean, we're not in the cage with the sharks, right? The shark is going
to separate us. Oh, you have a cage to protect you from the shark, right?
Yeah, I remember like Jaws, you know, like that cage that he went over in and Quint thought was the best idea ever.
How did that movie end again? Quint sailed away.
Quint
successful.
Never went in the cage.
I'll do a shark cage.
Would you do, Justin, would you do a shark cage?
Sure. I mean, you got to figure that the shark cage has not gone bad more times than it's gone bad, right?
I mean,
right.
At some
point.
I mean,
the thing is, it's the height of human engineering. We've welded this thing. It is a shark cage designed to keep a shark out. It's not like, let's go to Home Depot and get some chicken wire, you know? It is a special purpose thing. It has one purpose, to keep sharks out. So
I'm
I don't think anybody can guess where this is going. Well, Bryce, let's play a video of one of these shark dive trips.
Oh, my God. There's a
Oh, you got to start at the beginning, Bryce. You just
Oh my God, the shark is in the cage and the shark
bust through the gate, bust through, watch the sharks going around. They're feeding the sharks, they're baiting the shark. Shark is thrashing, and this is a big great white shark. I don't know. I mean, this is like a 13 footer or something. And it just smashed right through the top of the cage, right? Right through the top of the cage. Now it's inside the cage. There is a great white shark. It lived up to the name Shark Cage. And now they have a problem. They have a great white shark inside the cage. So they open up the top, and the great white shark is thrashing its way outside of the cage. And you're watching like, oh, God, thank goodness this cage was empty, you know? Because there are people on the boat going like, was there anybody in there? Like, no, it's totally cool. Everything's fine. So we're like, we're all cool here. That was kind of hilarious. And then... Wait for it.
Dude comes out of the cage. Okay, so I'm
oh my God.
There was a guy in there.
Oh my God.
There was a diver in the cage.
So he's just what, hiding at the bottom? You just make yourself very small?
Is writing the worst Yelp review ever.
So I guess like, at the end of the day, if you are going to have a lightning fast, terrifying chance encounter with a shark, right? Like that is just a thing that's going to happen. In the 10,000 foot view, right? You'd rather that like you are at the bottom of this cage where it's just thrashing and trying to get out more so than you are just in front of it in open water and it sees some sparkly thing on your scuba suit that it is now coming towards you, right?
I don't know how to weigh that because you understand, like, the diver saw this thing coming towards it and he had the benefit of seeing this thing coming through the cage.
Yeah.
Had he been, I don't know, facing the other way, looking at some shiny tuna or whatever like that, I don't know what... I don't think I want to be in a cage. It depends on what the shark's intentions are. The shark's intention was getting the tuna, not the diver. The shark's intention to be to get the diver inside the cage?
It seems as if the shark's intention was, oops, I got into this thing I don't know or understand that I want out of immediately.
And it looks like maybe it injured itself a bit because it the way it gets in is it's just going full speed, and I guess its nose just wedges right in between the bars and it keeps swimming and it's so powerful that it just squeezes its body through, thrashing through those bars, and then is in. I'd imagine the shark figured out pretty quick that it was in the wrong place, and kudos to the guy who thought to open the thing up and say like, swim out of there, little guy.
Because imagine if he's like, well, hell, we got ourselves a great white. 14 miles on us.
And then Edgar's down at the bottom like, guys, don't forget about Edgar.
We're good, right?
Man.
True story, I actually heard an interview with that guy.
With that guy?
The diver in the cage.
How did he describe it?
He is Chinese and was on vacation in Mexico.
And so how did the translation go?
So he just had, I mean, like he spoke good enough English to kind of describe it. It wasn't a great interview, and it was on a sports show that didn't really like, you know, want to press it because obviously that was kind of outside of their wheelhouse. But he was a dive instructor in Mexico, but he was back in Shanghai at like, you know, the point that they talked to him. Holy he said, you know, listen, it's a shark. It came through the thing. I tried to remain calm. And then eventually the shark left. It's like, yeah, I mean, I guess like, that's the thing is like
Hemingway.
You would imagine that at that point you're just doing whatever that amount of adrenaline makes you do at that point, right? Like
power,
that is just
fear,
all instinct
cry inside
and train.
My mask.
I mean, it's one
cover
of those.
Cover myself in a cloud of yellow urine.
I would imagine that you are, you know, in those strange moments. I would imagine it feels like time slows down and you become very pragmatic, where you think like, because we've had that where you're about to be in a car crash and you think to yourself, you have enough time to think, am I going to die? Looks like I might not die, but I could die. Oh, I appear to have not died. You know, I would imagine that's a whole bunch of that happening, only in Chinese.
So I think it's time for me to announce my new business venture.
All right, man. We've been waiting. Go.
Squirrel
encounter.
So
you know what the biggest problem with shark cages and shark encounters?
What's sharks? That?
Well, yeah, the sharks. Technically, it's also kind of the whole purpose. But you got to go underwater. You got to go do that. What if we want those sort of encounters, but we don't want to get wet?
You wear a dry suit?
Better. Better. You ready for this? Ready for this? Grizzly bear cage.
Oh, I think that's a thing. Didn't a guy build like a grizzly bear proof set of armor?
The suit, like they have shark proof wetsuits. I'm talking grizzly bear encounters where you get into a big cage.
Yeah,
like this one.
I think we got a video of it. Yeah, I've seen this this video. This brown bear goes to town.
This is the cage. So here you go. Guys out there, grizzly bear, like, it's funny, like, the difference between a regular bear and a grizzly bear is
well, I think this is a brown bear. As Nat Geo has
that
it labeled
is a brown bear.
As a brown
that is,
bear.
The grizzly has the moon face. The difference is, like, when you watch the grizzly, it's got, like, the big, big hunched shoulders. So this bear sniffing the guy out. He's like, all right, what is this idiot doing inside of that? This guy's, like, actually got food in front
he's
of there.
Got, like,
so
KFC.
This is a big bear tongue. Just a bear tongue is going through. It's like, can I have some of that? May I?
Yeah. Now, you see, this is also. He just put the four in. This is all like a domesticated. I mean, this is.
I think that means he wants in here.
I mean, of course they're gonna play it up and make it look like this thing was a man eater or whatever. But it's like my dog trying to play with a Kong to get the treat. I mean, they have a treat in there. The bear's trying to solve the puzzle. He's like, hey, man, look, what do you want me to do? I guess knock you around? Fine. I want the peanut butter, bro.
The bear's trying to find its way in there. The bear is now on top of it, turning over the cage. It's knocking the cage on the side. And the bear just tipped over the cage.
Manny did that like it was nothing. How do I get him to stand it back up?
The bear's like, I see your puny cage. You think you're so funny. How about if I turn you on the side?
I'd stand no chance.
I mean, the problem is, like, bears are actually kind of smart and stuff. So there you go. That's what we're going to open up. We're going to have our own grizzly bear encounters.
That looks kind of fun. He's just playing with you. He just wants to.
Bryce, the shark dive looked fun, too.
True.
If you have anything you want to add to that, feel free. Or you just want to let the idea just sit by itself. That's cool.
We're not hearing Justin.
Oh.
Yeah, I think what Andrew is trying to say is, like, you know, what you want is like to get like helicoptered in somewhere, right? Like in a big cage, and then have some drones come down with, like, you know, the kind of agitating meat. And then you get your real grizzly bear experience in a cage.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's the worst idea ever. But if we're going to make the worst idea an even worse idea, then we'll do that too. I mean,
as a potential investor in this idea, I'm confused. Because half of the things you're saying are how awesome it's going to be. The other half are going to be about how no one should do it because the bear's going to rip his way right in.
Dude, I think shark cage dives are a bad idea. I had a friend that wanted to go on one. I'm like, I don't think it's good for the shark. I don't think it's, you know, really good for the divers in some cases. And, you know, it's mostly safe. I'm like, yeah, but it's having them associate, you know, people with regulators and all this sort of stuff with sources of food, which I don't know if it statistically increases the likelihood of, you know, sharks getting attacked, but it also It draws sharks closer to boats, which is not healthy for the sharks, you know, as far as shark fishing, things like that. So
training them to think that food equals go to the boat
and no consequence or whatever. Yeah. I mean, it's one of these things like I'm kind of like, if you want to do it, but I'm like, don't think it's helping the sharks.
No, so, I think it's definitely not a good idea either, but if people wanted to do it, we could launch it as a Kickstarter. You know,
we could send Bryce. Like, Bryce could go on a shark cage dive and tell us all about it.
Bears need Bryce. Although, I mean, all right.
Hey.
The way to make that happen.
is to go to patreon.com/, well, I mean, there's many ways to make that happen, but patreon.com/nightattack is another way.
Nope, almost. It's patreon.com/weirdthings. That's what this show is called.
Jeez. All right. Hey, everybody. It's me, Justin Robert Young, fully awake and not frustrated by these tech problems. Patreon.com/weirdthings is where you support this show. Hey, here's a show for you. If you like it, you can go ahead and kick us a few ducats over there at Weird Things. Patreon.com/weirdthings. I've done that twice now, by the way. I did the entrance to Jury as the politics, and now I did the Patreon plug for Night Attack with Weird Things. I've crossed the wires on 4 different shows.
Yeah, we can add a 5th one in the mix. We're doing Night Attack right after this.
I know. So get ready for me to plug
the morning
Hotline
stream.
Monday on Night Attack tonight.
Gentlemen.
Yo.
You know what's going to happen.
What's
We're
that?
Only like days away.
What up?
The Europeans are going to try to land a probe on Mars. And Martian exploration, as far as probes go, is about a 50-50 chance of things succeeding. This was the Europeans have launched the ExoMars mission, which is the European Space Agency. And I believe that it was in conjunction with the Russians. I think the Russians may be doing the space probe portion of it. But they're going to try to land a probe on Mars, and they want to be able to try to see if they can't detect the chemical traces for life. So far, the only people to land a probe on Mars and have it last for more than a few seconds has been the United States. And this will hopefully break that streak of unlucky Mars exploration for other space agencies because, you know, we want more information about Mars. So this is the probe is called Schiaparelli, which is going to use its heat shield to sort of slow itself down to a less ridiculous velocity. And then it's going to have a parachute to slow it down even further. And then it's going to have some hydrazine engines, which are going to provide a rocket-assisted thrust for a slightly cushy landing. And then they have a crushable structure underneath so it can just kind of, you know, absorb that and Scrunch. Take the impact.
All right. Now, you said these are Europeans?
Yeah.
Because I didn't even know we had a base on Europa. Wah, wah. Stealing a joke from the chat room. Sorry. I didn't know that we were the only ones that the United States was the only ones who had successfully landed probes on Mars.
Well, no, the Russians have managed to land them on Mars. They just have only lasted the ones that didn't just create new craters, you know, only got like a few seconds of data before they died. And it's been interesting because it's like the as far as sending stuff out beyond Earth orbit into other worlds, other planets and moons and stuff, lately we've now been seeing some success with some other stuff. The European Space Agency and stuff is finally doing some stuff, you know, landing stuff on the comets, all that really, really awesome things. But it's been, you know, it's kind of hard from what I've heard and trying to get stuff.
I can only guess that if you are launching this kind of stuff, that you have a sense that there might be problems at some point before it lands, right? Like that these are complicated things that either, you know, if there's a problem in it launching or it you know, traveling to Mars, that it might be something that you could detect before.
Yeah, I mean, it depends. There's a lot of different things, places where things can go wrong. So like, for instance, in the early 1990s, the Japanese were sending a probe around the moon. And they could tell pretty quickly that it wasn't going to go into the right orbit, and they just assumed that it was going to be lost. But actually, some JPL scientists looked at it and said they figured out how to put it into a different kind of lunar orbit that was like a basically an energy-less orbit that would still let it get captured by the moon. They could still get data from it. But things can, you know, blow up on launch. They can have, you know, all sorts of from here to Mars. There's a lot of things that go wrong or anyplace else. But fingers crossed, because this will be really cool. So they've got the Trace Gas Orbiter spacecraft will remain in orbit and attempt to detect a wide range of atmospheric gases, particularly methane, or methane, as they say over there. And they want to try to find out, because Mars produces a bunch of methane, and any methane you find on Earth, you pretty much assume is coming from organic processes or biological processes. Versus when we see methane on Mars, we're like, well, we have no evidence of life, So maybe it's geological, but it could be a sign of biological. So it's going to be some really more interesting data points.
Yeah, do you remember when, was it the Pioneer or the Viking probes that originally had kind of a rudimentary aspect looking for signs of life, and it came back as positive? And then like for an electric few days, it was like, what? Life confirmed on Mars?
They had a chemical sensor package on board there, and the guy by the name, I forget his name, was in charge of that, still insists that it detected evidence of life on Mars. But it's one of those things where there was a presence of a certain chemical, or forget what it is, some sort of biological process, but it was too faint enough to be like, this is life. But then it was other indications were, but then there is no other explanation for it. And it just kind of like, it was one of these things like, just not enough data to know. And there's so many other things that we don't know, so many processes that take place there. And so, but it's interesting, forget the name of the guy, but if you look him up, he's the one who was in charge of that package. He's like insistent, like, no, we found it. This is proof. And it's hard because like anything we find on the surface, this is an environment that is intensely, stricken by radiation. It would have to be, you know, there's no analog on Earth at any Earth altitude comparable to what would be like. So if you try to figure out what would life look like, how would it, you know, it's, how would it function? You know, what would its rate of biological processes be? You know, hard to know, you know? So what are the traces of life? We can figure out the basic ones, but in what presence, what degrees for soil?
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what, it gets really interesting. Like, obviously, you know, Mars was not always the way it is right now. So mm-hmm. if you presume there was a time that it was lush and had lots of water, and let's say there was a brief moment that life was as ubiquitous on Mars as it is here, like, we can't find a crack or a crevice anywhere that doesn't have something thriving. You know, those thermal vents at the bottom of the ocean where it's super, super cold, but there's a little bit of heat, and they got this whole bizarro life set up. Like, I wonder if, wouldn't it be a trip if we began to colonize Mars, we began to terraform Mars, we're moving in, doing our thing, and then we discover down in one of those lava tubes, those giant caverns that you were talking about underground, maybe there's a moderate heat source, and then there's a whole fundamentally different version of life there.
That's going to be the ongoing question is that, and by the way, in my book, how to make money on Mars, I talk about like the different scenarios of like, the only positive information scenario we have is if we go there and we find it. If we don't find it, we don't know that it's not there. You know, we can't rule out every single crevice or place that you mentioned. And there's a lot. Mars has become a much more complex place as we look at it, where there's geysers, there's CO2 geysers, and they may actually be driven by geothermal activity, which would provide your warm water in those hot environments. We know that there are glaciers on Mars, just right below the regolith. There are actual glaciers there. And if you have sources of heat and you have underground sources of liquid water, there could be that. You have lithotrophs, which are organisms on Earth that happily munch away on rocks. If you the sun shut down, the sun's like, guys, I'm sorry, Galactus just ate me, I'm gone. Life on Earth could last for millions or billions of years, because there's so many forms of life that are not at all dependent upon the photosynthesis, not participating in photosynthesis. You know, bottom of the ocean bottom feeders wait for things to fall down. Things are coming out of geothermal vents, as you point out. It's not the sun powering that. And then like these lithotrophs, which are inside the core, not the core, but in like just in the crust, they function without. And that's when we start thinking about where to look for life in the rest of the universe. It's who knows what really the habitable zone is.
Do you think that that would be like the mother of all financial disasters? Like, you know, it's like here on Earth, you decide to make a development or build a building, and then you discover the Barton Springs salamander is unique to this area, and then they lock it all down. Do you do that for a whole planet, or do you just say, yeah, look, aliens going to be over there, don't worry about it, we're going to be over here?
NASA's NASA has these protocols that they put everything through before they send them there so that we don't like ruin the planet before we get a chance to look at it. And like, so SpaceX and NASA are, you know, they're doing the red Martian, watching too much Supergirl here. They're doing the Red Dragon probe, which they're going to try to launch next year in following NASA's guidelines to avoid contamination. But NASA's said, NASA's like, listen, our goal is to be able to do good science, good research, but it's not like to quarantine the planet and to never go there or never colonize. We look at colonization and develop this as a viable thing that could happen. So what we want to do is as more we explore, we want to get these data points and understand that contamination is going to be inevitable at some point, you know, but just make sure that we get as much data as we can. Not unlike how we do archaeological digs now, where we'll dig up part of it, but we'll leave part of it over there. And, you know, if Martian life is too fragile that any presence of us there could kill it, we may have wiped it out years ago. We've had so many meteor impacts on Earth that have sent Earth debris there. And there are these weird events that happen, too, where bits of our upper atmosphere get pulled away and solar winds can connect to other planets. So contamination could have already happened.
Wait, just by like straight up the sun blowing some Earth air, makes it through space, ends up on Mars?
Yep.
That's amazing.
Yeah, I mean, it has to be the right, you know.
Sure. It's not like an everyday thing.
We're losing hundreds and hundreds of tons of our atmosphere every day in that way. Solar winds and such is blowing stuff off in streams, and sometimes it forms little bubbles and globules. And, you know, you'd be getting intense amounts of radiation, but we've seen things like tardigrades that survive that. And when we look in the upper atmosphere, when we do big samplings, we find bacteria and stuff that survives up there. And we're now aware of bacteria that participates in the hydrological cycle that actually does cloud seeding. So, you know, there could be our biosphere could expand to all the other planets.
Man, that's crazy.
Yeah, prior to us just showing up in mass.
That's some crazy trash right there.
You know what else is crazy? Speaking of mysterious red objects, we'll just do this really quick, is New Horizons, which has been another great success stories of space exploration, is heading towards a, quote, mysterious red object.
Who did what now?
New Horizons spacecraft.
Right.
Right. NASA's New Horizons spacecraft is heading towards the Kuiper Belt object known as MU69.
I totally thought you were playing coy, and then sure enough, the headline is it's just approaching a mysterious red object. That's amazing.
Yep. So this thing's about 30 miles in diameter. It's about, you know, about 1.6 billion miles beyond Pluto. So it'll get there about 2019, which is, by the way, Blade Runner time. Just saying, that's when Blade Runner was like set. So, anyhow, it's another interesting object out there. Instead of just this strange weirdo ball of like, oh, just another bit of ice, it's got a reddish surface. They think that it's produced by some sort of interaction between, like ultraviolet radiation and methane and ethane. They call it tholine, which doesn't form naturally here, but it's present very much in the outer bodies. There's so many weird geochemistries and chemistries just taking place in our solar system. You know, it's not like we'll find minerals and things like this or find metals like we have here, but there are other things in abundance that just don't exist here. There's a whole catalog of stuff that you can find in impact craters. Not on Earth, but in other places when you have much higher velocity impacts, which is just like forms of quartz and stuff that just you don't see here. And so anyhow, I digress. Strange red object. So who knows what's out there? What's really there?
We have no idea what it might be. We have no idea what it would be.
Well, I mean, we know we have an idea what it is.
Yeah, it's a rock. Sure. It's some kind of minerals.
Icy rock, but it's a reddish icy rock.
Yeah. No, that's awesome.
Yeah.
That means it's angry.
Yeah. You know what would be cool would be a faster way to get there.
Wait. Are you talking about what I'm thinking you're talking about?
Ryan, we're talking about what you're talking about. So there has been an update to the EM drive patent. One of the people who's been developing the EM drive, there's several different versions of this. Roger Sawyer was, I think, the first one to file a patent for what he described as the EM drive. Now, let's be very, very clear, folks. I think if we do a roundtable show of hands of how many of us think that this is likely to be a real thing that will ever work, I don't think any of us is in a rush to raise our hands.
I mean, actually, no. I'm in a rush to immediately backpedal and say, like, I don't know science. All I know is, like, that sounds cool. But so last time we talked about this, we talked about it in the context that NASA had done some proof of concept experiments that seemed to indicate that this EM drive could work, essentially propulsion without exhaust.
Well, so, no, I think the issue was more that it wasn't totally unproven than that it was proven to work, right?
Yeah, and to clarify, NASA, there's a group called NASA has their Eagle Works, which does like a lot of like fringe propulsion research and stuff. And I totally think that is a great idea, that we spend some money on some of these crazier things, that if there is some laboratory evidence, or if we're hearing from credible people like, yeah, there's something weird here. I think it's worth, even like, you know, something like cold fusion, which was just a debacle, but there was something to the idea of having other laboratories say, listen, this makes no sense, but let's at least try to replicate this experiment, because it's not going to cost billions of dollars to do that. I mean, you're talking to a guy who spent 7 years of his life developing tests for the paranormal and the supernatural, who would arguably say does not believe any of that is real. But
right. Know. But if it was, it would be like the most revolutionary thing ever.
Yeah, we can't, you know, that we get into this sort of weird thing, and I see this in stuff that talks about a lot of things, like, well, science says this, and like, science does not say anything. If science is telling you something, you're hearing voices in your head, you know. Science is a process.
Right.
You can say, you know, people who've done this process and come up with very convincing evidence or say this, but when people start using the word science as an argument from authority, it's very frustrating, because it is not. It is the most brilliant process ever for figuring out how things work. But it is not this declarative, firm, case closed, argument over book of knowledge.
Right.
That being said, something as extreme that is this, that violates our basic physical laws as we understand them, you know, needs to kind of be proven to work before you say, let's throw out what we know or believe.
Sure.
Okay. So what's the news here?
The news is that the patents from the guy who had this idea, he's been working on it a few decades, just released. And patents, of course, are public. And so you can
We had patents before. He did an update.
Got it.
Yeah. He first filed his first, like, back in 2000. So he added now like a superconducting plate to it.
Who wants to make a bet? You think this is the real deal or no go?
I mean, my bet is do I think that this thing is a real thing that will function? My bet is no. Am I all for some credible researcher spending some time looking into it? 100%.
You know, this is one of the things. I'm going to give you a preview as to what my pick is going to be, because I'm reading Nassim Nicholas Taleb's latest book, Anti-Fragile, and he talks about how evolution and biology is an individual life is fragile, and that it will die, you know, if it's in the wrong place, wrong conditions, and so on. But the system of population, the genetic code, is extremely anti-fragile, in that every time a unit dies, an individual person dies, that is injecting information into the system that is causing the population to get more robust and stronger and anti-fragile, as he calls it. It occurs to me that science is much the same way. Like, this may be complete crankery, but it is good for science as a whole that this is being pursued, because in the event something that it is a breakthrough, that's great. And if it's not a breakthrough, there's going to be still even more that will be learned as a result of it.
Yeah, we have to, you know, there's the dangerous area of crank stuff that's been pretty well debunked, that people keep pushing forward and, you know, developing conspiracy theories and stuff of why this hasn't been accepted, all that. And there's a danger of spending too many resources on chasing down everything like that. But to outright say no to something because it violates our theoretical framework is not a good policy. If somebody says, hey, we push theoretical boundaries and we find outlier data. And the question is the outlier data credible or not? And if you can replicate this relatively easily, then let's do it. You know, let's do that, which people are doing.
This whole situation has become, you know, the EM drive has become famous because it seems to be something that is not easily, but something that violates, obviously, are the tenets of how we understand the universe, and yet it's hung around. And there is, I think, mm-hmm. but we've waited for the shoe to drop on EM drive doesn't work. Like, and yet that story has not come. And now there is continued kind of fame derived from that. Like that'd be a safe way to describe this, right?
Yeah. And there are some things like, dude, our universe is weird. You ever heard of like the idea of TARDIS regions?
TARDIS regions? No. Are they named for the Doctor Who TARDIS? Wow.
One of the theories behind dark energy and the reason why our universe continues to expand is that you might have bubbles of space of the universe that is expanding at a different rate. And some of these bubbles would actually have more room on the inside than they do on the outside, and maybe functioning to have different sort of within different time frames and stuff. And this is a, you know, if you look at the theories of dark energy, this is, you know, one of the explanations for where this expansion is coming from. And it's just this, we don't know that this is true, but really, really smart people who understand this stuff much better than I do will tell you like, hey, this is an explanation that fits the numbers as far as we can look at it. So, you know, I'll just go like, cool, TARDIS regions.
That's awesome.
And that's what I'm saying. Like, so that's like when we get into like some fringe stuff, like people who are like, oh, I have this, you know, device that puts out more energy than it takes in. It's like, well, we can test that, you know, and that's easily, it's interesting because you've seen, we've had in the last 10 years or so, there actually been a couple startups that were promising to get funded and stuff because they thought they had sort of breakthrough. And it's like, man, I want to talk to their venture capitalist.
Yeah.
You know, I got asked a while ago on one of them, you know, a friend of mine who was a VC had said, hey, would you take a look at this? And, you know, I did say like, well, I would talk to this person here and this person here because this is a problem. But it's like, you know, there's certainly a desire to see the rules bent and to find that breakthrough stuff. But, you know, anyhow, I digress. Gentlemen, is it time for Journey Quest?
I believe it is. Where were we last left?
Last left, you guys were about to rocket over a canyon wall as a school bus filled with refugees, plague refugees, was being terrorized by a whole horde of engineering.
Yeah, that's right. If I remember correctly, the plan was we were gonna attract them, get them to come chase us up. We were gonna create a diversion, and then we're gonna take the rocket on down, right?
Rocket on down, see if you can help fix the bus and get it going. I think it's a good plan, by the way, Brian. Your solution surprised me, I will tell you that.
It's good. It's good. See, every so often I rub the neurons correctly.
So I have a quick question. I was thinking about this, and just to back up kind of like in thinking about all this apocalypse stuff, if like let's say we got a news alert, CNN was like, hey, listen, turns out tomorrow night, oops, there's going to be a meteor that's going to slam into, you know, the Pacific Ocean. And it's going to be big. It's going to be big. It's going to be disruptive. It's going to probably screw up our weather and all that. It's not like a dinosaur killer, but, you know, it could be a United States of America killer as far as, you know, civil order and all that. Not to mention what poor tiny islands get caught in its wake. So, you know, it's going to cause tsunamis. It's tidal waves, disruptive, probably put enough stuff in front of like, you know, the sun for a while. We might shut down, you know, the greenhouse process, the photosynthesis for a while, whatever. We don't know. It could strip away. It might be clear nights, and it might be like just a fiery inferno too, you know. And then Anderson Cooper starts to cry, and then you're like, okay, I know what I need to do. This is what you guys need to do. You ready?
Yeah.
You go to Amazon. Right. Amazon.com.
Right.
And you're like, all right, I'm going to order something because Amazon says, you know what? We're going to still make deliveries happen until this thing happens. But you only get one item. You only get one item because get as much as you want, but you get one item. That's our rule.
Well, so I mean, it's got to be a bounce house, right? I mean, because you're clearly screwed. You might as well be bouncing on a bounce house while
we'll give you a free Atom item too, Brian, of a bunch of little yo-yos and some other stuff.
Yeah, no, just something shiny is all I want.
I mean, I just want those confetti sticks that who's it, Rip Taylor had. Like, I'm just like, it's the end of the world! Yay!
So, So let me be clear, like, Brian, you don't need to really worry about, like, the concussion from the impact.
Oh, no, no, no. I understand. You're saying that it's a weatherable storm that will.
But you're like, no, I understand. I just want a damn carnival.
Yeah, man. It's like, I'm going to host the wicked ass party. I'm going to get the biggest bounce house they got.
All right. You're going to go. I'm going to throw this out there. Let's say that the plan is you want a resource that would, what would you want to hold on to for trade? Because you're like, oh, civil order is going to fall apart. You're not going to die.
I mean, to be honest, because you're right. The only way you're going to survive is if you trade. The idea of self-sufficiency is not going to be great in the apocalypse. And you're going to have to trade. So if you're going to trade, you want something that's extremely valuable but also extremely small. Precious minerals, I don't think are going to be worth much unless they're, you know, until some kind of economy based on blacksmithing starts. To be honest, my plan is just to get all the booze, to have all the booze. Humans will always trade a lot of valuable things for booze.
Can you buy alcohol on Amazon?
I don't know.
Oh.
Can you buy cocaine? I can buy anything. I bet there's medicines. I bet there's. Oh, there it is. There's booze.
Alcoholic beverages are not listed on Amazon except for wine and beer.
Well, that's starting. Amazon's. Wait, Island Bay rum? Wait, it says that and then it shows rum.
Oh, and it's Prime, too.
This is
weird.
Hair extensions.
Hair extensions.
And men's cologne.
And, men's and country, digital music. Digital music country, so.
I'm going to go for some kind of narcotic. If there's drugs I can order, I'll order those
on
drugs.
Amazon?
Yeah, I'm sure they have like a pharmacy section or something. Not cocaine.
Energy drink. There you go. $20 a can.
Like type in ibuprofen. I bet you can order drugs. So I'm going to scour around and find the best drugs I can get my hands on.
You get one item, one drug, one, but yeah, as much as if you want.
I mean, if you want to stop the podcast, I can take a long time and search by trial and error. But
yes, Brian, because this counts. This matters. Let's stop the podcast so you can do your research and you can file a report. Let's give you a quick answer. What do you want?
I don't know. You won't let me. You're restricting me to the Amazon, but you won't let me check. So I'm shortening it by saying what the best drugs I can find on Amazon. If you would like, I can search.
I pick baked beans. Baked beans is what I would pick. I would do the old what is Ted and Heidi Cruz where they got each other canned goods for their marriage. I think that was a wise decision in light of this whole meteor thing. Baked beans for me.
All right. There's a warning that flashes on the Amazon site. It says, "Hey, we're about to shut the site down. You know, we know a lot of people are trying to wait to decide, but you got to get your order in now."
Baked beans in more plus infinity.
I get unbaked beans because I'm hoping they'll last longer.
Like, listen, man, I think your drug, like ibuprofen, might be a good choice. Like, there's no wrong answer. I have no way to test this, by the way. We hope.
Sure. Yeah.
I really hope that this is all in the panicked few moments before we launch off the side of the thing in our rocket. Like,
yeah, I'm really confused how we got
where
here.
We are going with this particular thing in the midst of this journey quest moment.
I was in my dream version of this. It was a spontaneous like, oh, I don't know this. Not like, hey man, I need to research this because obviously it matters. I'm thinking the one thing I can't live without, the one thing that they don't deal with an apocalypse scenario is the thing that frustrates me and the thing that I'd be very, very, like every time I'm middle like Mysterious Island by Jules Verne and there's talk about how they're building their own iron forges and, you know, sailing vessels and all this sorts of stuff. And the thing that I keeps going through my head, and the thing I'm thinking about Mars, I'm like, what about the toilet paper? What about toilet paper? I'm thinking maybe that's what I would stock up on.
No way, dude. In the future, we're going to be civilized. Even in a post-apocalyptic future, we'll wash our bottoms like civilized Japanese businessmen. Not toilet paper smearing dead trees on our butts. That's crazy talk.
What method do you know of, Brian?
Oh, man. I get some kind of bidet. Get a proper hose. Wash that. I mean, if I get mud on my hands, I don't just wipe it on an envelope and declare it clean. I wash my hands. In the future, that's what I would want us to do.
always thought it was a multi-step process, but you're saying just skip that first part of the process of the toilet paper and jump right to the...
I mean, if... Are you sure? I mean,
whatever. So we're in a rocket, and we are about to go off the side of this cliff, right?
Fine.
Yeah, sorry if we're trying to top from the bottom. I'm just real confused.
You're in a rocket. You're about to launch. You launch. You land. There's the bus. What happens next? Who cares at this point? Because somebody's got an itchy butt. I'm not going to name names. And he's shifting a lot in his seat. the rocket. Okay, you guys ready? All of a sudden, you see them coming up the side of the hill. They're side of the mountain. They're coming after you, right? And so you're waiting. You're waiting like to the last moment, right?
Yeah. Yes.
You press the ignition button. Rocket takes off, right? Both of you are on it, board, right? Right? You waited?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Now, I'm going to point out that it was like meant for one person.
Oh, no, but that's fine. We're spooning each other. I'm on the bottom, and I have my arms wrapped all the way around his midsection, and just a little joke. I give him a little nipple tweak as I say, go for liftoff.
But then I actually shift his arms so he's covering my breasts like Janet Jackson on the cover of Rolling Stone. Ask your parents.
All right. Lift off. The rocket accelerates. Justin, your body's pushed back into Brian's. Deep, hard, intense. There's like trying to form just one body as the acceleration of the G-force is just to combine you. And maybe Brian's arms are a little bit tighter than they need to because of the G-forces. We're not judging. It's just a rocket accelerating, okay?
Just trying to survive out here.
You hear me whisper from behind you, like, just like I dreamed. But then I cough. I act like I was just coughing when I said that.
Good.
Rocket takes off.
Yeah.
It's going up. It's going really, really fast, really, really high. And you look down and you see the school bus below you.
Uh-huh.
And you're always like, man, do we like just shut down the thruster and do this parachute right now? Or are we going to try to like just, how are we going to land this thing?
That's a real good question. I assume there are controls of some. Hey, Justin, are there controls?
No.
All right. Well, then I guess we'll just see. It's probably got like an autopilot. We'll just let it do its sequence.
Wait, I don't know. Dungeon Master, does it have controls?
Yeah, it's got controls.
Brian, LOL, it's got controls. I was just joking. It's another hilarious jape from the old gerbs.
The parachute deploys. The rocket now starts to descend and land, sort of nose first, but then it's in a 1 in a million chance it actually lands back on its wheels. It does have wheels there. It was meant to like go across a canyon from level ground to level ground, not drop down into a canyon. It was a really... Your use of it was unconventional, but for some quirk of physics and fate, you guys actually survived, and you landed actually on top of the school bus.
Oh, yes. Wow. Congrats.
And so now we've trapped, or at least distracted, the marauding gang up into the hills as they try to come get us. We have come back down, so they're going to be searching for us for at least another couple minutes. Right?
I would imagine they were able to see which way. My guess is that they would turn around because we did take off in a rather flamboyant manner.
Well, they had to go into the hills to get up to where we were, right?
Sure, yeah. No, we got a little time, but
they had to go through a winding path, and like they don't even know that you're not there anymore. You just
hear them
like, let's get them. We're going to get them, right? And so you're now on top of the school bus, okay?
Yeah.
You guys swivel on down, swing on over, you land, just do this kind of really macho sort of landing in a sprawl, just standing there like, yo, what's up? Hands on hips.
Yeah.
And you see these faces pressing. Remember, there's the little boy who was like pressing his face against the window and had little sister next to him too. And he's all smile, his face is all smiling, and people are waving at you. And they're like, you're here to save us. But they're saying it in Spanish, but both of you guys learned how to speak Spanish, so it's all cool.
Yeah.
Hey, guys, I say in Spanish, we got to get out of here.
Yo, locos, mis tocadiscos, es descompuesto. ¿Qué película vamos a ver?
And they stare at each other for a moment, and then just smile again and wave. And then the bus driver comes out from the front of it, and he's holding like a broken distributor cap.
Okay.
Hey, Justin, if I'm not mistaken, that appears to be a broken distributor cap.
You know, I bet you a rocket has a distributor cap.
Hey, man,
it turns out you actually had some spare supplies and stuff with you. You had like a distributor cap. And he's like, oh, guys, thank you so much.
Oh, no, they're sick.
And then the little boy's waving and he coughs. The next thing you know, there's a spray of blood on the window.
Oh, no. I mean, yeah, we're immune, right? It's not like we just were lucky and never got infected. I have to assume we're the chosen survivors.
What are you basing that on?
I'm assuming if a disease is ubiquitous enough that it kills everyone.
It killed everybody,
yeah,
right?
I'm going to guess at some point we were exposed to it, especially since we definitely, you know, all these bodies everywhere and everything. I'm assuming. I mean, I guess we'll find out.
Well, I mean, listen, we're going to assume that because otherwise we're already effed.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, there ain't nothing else. I mean, look, let's worry about the tomorrow problem of what to do when these guys are all corpses. For now, I'm worried about the right now problem of whether or not we're about to become corpses.
I say, hey, listen, Padre, why don't you go ahead and hit the back? I'm going to slip this distributor cap. I'll take the wheel. Brian, you grab an acoustic guitar because we got to get the F out of D.
All right, so I grab the acoustic guitar and I sort of clumsily strike an E chord. And then I'm like, hold on. And then it's like I strum it again. And it's like I start playing like the first few chords of the first few notes of the Beatles' Blackbird. But then I'm like, nope, hold on. And then I do it again. And then I pause awkwardly and I'm like, hold on, I used to know this. And then I keep on plucking the same things over and over again. Never quite getting it down, but hoping that I'm going to get it.
Even in the fictional scenario, even in this, anything in that, we just landed on the bus with Evel Knievel's rocket, and you can't figure out how to play Blackbird.
Well, I mean, it's just, I used to, back in college, I knew it really good, right? But now, I mean... Look, I just got off of a rocket. I'm a little bit frazzled. Okay.
Brian's still explaining to me how he used to know it really, really well. He swears, as we pull out with the bus away from back onto the where we remember the main highway to be.
All right, so you're towing the rocket vehicle. The rocket vehicle's on top. You strapped it down to the top of the bus.
Yeah.
So you're all in the bus driving along, right? Hightail it away. You find a highway. You do some dodge and turns. You get around there and... Finally, this guy comes running from the back, and he's wearing, like, doctor scrubs. And you're like, oh, finally, a doctor. And you notice, but actually, there's, like, little cats and dogs. He may be a vet. You know, you haven't asked him.
So when you say doctor scrubs, you're not saying he's wearing the skin of a man who was once Dr. Scrubs. You're saying he's wearing appropriate gear for a doctor.
Yeah.
We'll assume that. We'll go that way. So he's like, guys, so God, we've been hoping to find you. We heard about you. We've been listening to your podcast that you've been doing. It's really, really good stuff. We tried to go to Patreon, but like doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah, no, that's the problem.
He's like, listen, I don't know if you noticed this, but the people here, don't mind me. I always had this cough. It's good.
Sure.
He's like, oh, the blood's coming out of his nose, his mouth. Like, yeah, I just some gum disease. It's fine.
Sure. I look in my rucksack to see if I have any limes to give him. Maybe it's scurvy. But then I realize that it's presumptuous for me to try to diagnose Dr. Scrubs.
Yeah, okay, he's like, Brian, that's very presumptuous of you, but I will have that lime. And he bites the lime. He's like, ah, it stings my gums, the citric acid. Why would you do that to me? So, it's like, listen, these people are in bad shape, but I need your help. Need your help.
Well, sure. I mean, we just rescued you.
Listen, as you like to say, huddle up, okay?
All right.
We do like to say that. That's it. Hey, Justin, do you want to say it or should I?
It's a classic. No, Dr. Scrubs said this.
Dr. Scrubs, no, he's doing the bit. Go ahead, DS. What's shaking?
He's like, listen, guys, so... I don't think everybody here is going to be able to make it. In fact, I don't know if anybody here is going to make it, but there's a way we can improve their odds.
Go on.
Mm-hmm.
Blood donation.
Oh, like you want some of our blood?
Yeah, I do. Well, I'm going to need a lot of blood.
Like
how much is the lot here, dude?
Depends. The more you give, the more I can save.
Yeah. All right, real quick, Justin, take a look at the gas indicator. Or what's the gas indicator at? Like, are we sure we're free? Like, we're just on the road. We're mobile.
Yeah, I take a look at the gas indicator.
On the bus.
Yeah. What does it read?
Wait, you're like 3/4 of a tank. They filled it up. You're good.
All right. Okay. All right. So it seems like, yeah, you know what? Go ahead and just tap a vein, go to town, take as much as you can. Go for it.
Yeah. You want to know what, Brian? Great call. Brian's going to be the blood guy. I'm going to be the driver. So you go ahead, Brian. You go ahead and give. You're the real MVP. That's what I like to say. So I'm.
The driver's like, no, I'm good. I've been driving this bus since South America.
Oh, no, this is great. That's double the blood. We've got clean blood.
Here, see, the problem is that you never know. That driver, I've seen him coughing, too. I bet you need some of that Brian blood. BP is what I like to call it. That's what he's
like,
got it on all of his shirts.
Let's start with the first withdrawal. See that little girl who just passed out while you're trying to tune your guitar?
Yeah.
Let's start with her. Let's start with her. You owe it to her, at least.
Yeah. All right, Brian, go give that blood.
I squeeze a vein and then like I take some iPod earbuds and make a tourniquet. And I'm like, go for it, DS.
The doctor says, let me get my medical bag. And he goes over and he grabs a paper shopping bag.
Yeah.
It's the apocalypse. Clean one. Yeah, there are stains on there.
We're all doing our best. He pulls out a Philly cheesesteak and starts eating.
Hey, Brian.
What?
Huddle up real quick.
Oh,
huddle
man,
up.
That's what we say. Hey, what's up?
I don't think this is a real doctor.
I mean, no, look, and I'm not
His
a real
name
podcaster.
Is Dr. Scrubs.
I know, but come on. Like, we're all stepping outside our...
Let's just real quick pretend like you're still... This is still going to happen. I'm going to run interference real quick, okay? All right? Hey, Dr. Scrubs. I love doctors. Where did you go to medical school?
Well, I started medical school actually in North Carolina, actually, honestly.
Oh, whereabouts?
Chapel Hill.
That sounds like a place with schools.
Chapel Hill.
Pardon me?
What school is in Chapel Hill?
Well, I was pre-med. I mean, I wasn't like full-on med. I mean, I'm not really a doctor, guys. I mean, I was like a relief worker, an aid worker, like helping stuff, like the, you know. You know, I had the scrub.
Where were you relieving?
I'm rooting around in his bag looking for like maybe a scalpel or something and maybe a mayonnaise jar.
Scalpels, it's rusty, some syringes. He pulls out the syringe. He's like, dude, I'll help you. Here's the syringe.
Oh, thank you.
Hold on, okay. Let me wipe this off on my shirt. And he wipes the needle off on
his
shirt.
All right, hey, Dr. Scrubs, listen. Number one, I'm not going to let you puncture my friend here.
Oh, no, yeah, no, I'll do it for him. It's fine. They need
the
blood, Justin.
No, Brian. We don't even know whether or not this wackadoodle here actually knows that your blood's going to save that little girl.
Well, and actually, he didn't really explain what he was going to do with the blood. Hey, Dr. Scrubs, what were you going to do with my blood?
Well, I'm glad you asked that. What I'm going to do with your blood, find out next time on Journey Force.
He also didn't ask what your blood type is, which is
But we don't know what process he was doing. Maybe he just needs to refine some antigens or something.
Maybe he also just remembers that famous Night Attack bit where we talked about our blood type.
Yeah, they're big fans. Sure. He was like, gentlemen, I listened to Night Attack 72. Brian's O positive.
I'm O positive. It's time for picks.
Yeah. Ooh.
Yeah, my pick is Nassim Taleb's latest Anti-Fragile, which he goes to great pains to explain. Like, apparently you could tell he was trying this idea on a bunch of people, and they all were like, well, the opposite of fragile is robust. And he's like, no, robust means you're indifferent to stresses. Anti-Fragile means you actually benefit from stresses. And basically, you know, think about like the way your muscles get stronger as a result of the fractures and destruction that happens when you are working out, or the way a tree is actually made stronger by the stress of the branches and the wind and all that stuff.
What is the name of the author there?
Nassim Nicholas Taleb.
I think when it comes to Taleb's writing and his inability to write a book where he doesn't make up a term, he is a black swan.
There is a Wall Street Journal review of this book by none other than Mr. Matt Ridley.
Oh, sweet.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, he mentions Matt Ridley in there at some point.
Fix is in.
The fix, yeah. Old big word cabal comes together to force feed us another idea.
I'm actually really excited to read this because I very much enjoyed the Black Swan, and that was very much, I think, a book, you know, it's similar to Wisdom of the Crowds and Freakonomics, that was like very much of its era to kind of define a style of writing that I very much enjoy.
Yeah. Although they do something that I've never experienced in an Audible book before. They have the parts where he curses, but they bleep the cursing. So when when he says BS, it's bull bleep. And then and I'm just like, well, did he write that? Is that in the book or not? Or
wow, that's weird.
Yeah.
I've definitely heard a lot of cursing in a lot of different ways in a lot of Audible books.
Yeah.
Huh. Well, I'll be.
What about you guys?
I'm going to just do a just a quick side, though. So Nassim is a very interesting guy, but, you know, he was supposed to get into a debate with Ronald Bailey about GMO, and then he backed out of it. He calling Nick Gillespie an idiot and whatnot. So he's got a very interesting ideas, but he's a man with many opinions.
Oh, yeah, dude.
Hey, what? An academic that has thin skin and embarrasses himself by way of social mores? No, okay. I've seen everything.
Yeah, he's very anti-GMO. I don't know. I don't think the book doesn't touch on GMO stuff, does it?
I haven't gotten there, but it is funny because what you just said, Justin, literally was in the chapter that I just finished where he talks about, like, academics, they all have a scarcity mentality and they're all thin-skinned and they have grudges and blah, blah, blah. Who needs these jerks?
Yeah.
But then he also was talking about how big and buff he is now, like, because somebody was saying intimidating stuff. I don't know. I'm enjoying it a lot.
Wait, is it some sort of like prison screen? Like
he has a leg day chapter.
Don't F with me, because I will knife you.
Well, basically, he said like some people are saying, you better just watch yourself, you know, vague threatening stuff or whatever. And so other people are like, man, you should get a bodyguard when you're in a big city or whatever. And so he was like, no, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna look like a bodyguard. How about that? And then he goes on. He's like, man. You know what's a problem is when you're a smart academic, but you look so ripped that it intimidates people. I'm Nassim Taleb.
Yeah. No, that certainly seems like a thing that belongs in a book. And not a Tinder profile.
Nonetheless, it sounds like this on this topic sounds very, very interesting. So that sounds cool. Justin, did I already ask you?
You did not. All right. So I got a pick, and it's not something that I liked, but it is something that I found very, very interesting. I was on the flight back, and I actually texted Andrew about this because I was so excited while I was watching it. It is the movie Truth. It came out last year, and it is the story from the perspective, adapted from the book of Marley Mapes, the former producer for 60 Minutes. She produced the, I forget, Peabody Award, I think, winning report on Abu Ghraib, which was, certainly universally recognized to be excellent television journalism. But this movie focuses on her spearheading of the 60 Minutes 2 report of the investigation into George W. Bush's service in the Texas Air National Guard, which famously kind of went sideways and cost Dan Rather his job. Dan Rather is played by Robert Redford. This movie is to the story that I remember reading about effectively, like, as I imagine, I have not seen Wicked. As I imagine that Wicked is to The Wizard of Oz. Like, it is just a totally backwards narrative to how I understand it. However, I would very much encourage this. If you are interested, especially at this time of year, where we are now, yet again in a moment in time where, everything is very politically charged, that you read about that entire situation and you watch that movie and you see where even in that movie there are little outs given to the argument that, you know, this movie prosecutes the idea that, sure, everyone knows that these documents are fake, but what this movie presupposes is maybe they're not. Just watch, read about the situation, watch the movie, and pick it apart for yourself or agree with it. I just think it's a very fascinating movie.
You know, political cinema, you know, I guess is a way to one way to look at it, and both the books and stuff like that. It is a fascinating thing because those things are they are designed to stoke the emotions, you know. And it's one of these things where if you think your emotional case is strong enough, then the facts don't matter as much, which is sort of a weird thing that we would all say we disagree with that. But then you get into the whole outrage sort of thing of like, but what if the crime is so outrageous? Should we have a trial kind of mentality? Yeah. You know, and that's like we saw that with like accusations of like child molestation and things like that. Like, well, it's such an incredible allegation. Maybe we don't need due process here. It's like, well, it's maybe really the case to actually make sure you have that because it's so charged. And whenever you watch things to deal with politics, that's like, you know, it's whenever somebody says, oh, you know, what do you think about this? Like this, like, you know, there's a documentary. I'm like, stop right there. Stop right there. You know, like if that's your primary source of a rebuttal, you know, it can be an introduction to a topic. But if that is your first, your starting, your end point, it's always frustrating.
So here's the biggest thing that I always took away from that particular situation was, to me, it was that along with Matt Drudge unspiking the Newsweek story about Monica Lewinsky, the two moments wherein news media was forever changed because of the internet, where the idea of the democratic masses affecting what used to be a very top-down news media became not only possible but also the norm, and specifically how fast it happened in the 60 Minutes 2 case. What I found very interesting about the movie is that it is very obviously written from a modern perspective. So, for example, Marley Mapes, in the middle of all this storm, there is a scene, spoiler alert, wherein she is reading the comments on the blog posts that are refuting her work. And they are, as comments on blog posts very often are, saying nasty things about her. Now, at the time, and I remember it because I was living in, the idea of media structure was such that the comments section of a blog was not what we think of it today. Today, my grandma can read what's happening on YouTube because internet is so ubiquitous. The idea of a comment section becoming e-bullying is very, very common and understood now. It certainly was not then. And the idea that 60 Minutes 2, which was the word, or 60 Minutes, which was the word of God, effectively, and very rarely unchallenged, couldn't take nasty things being said about it was kind of ridiculous. I mean, in the moment in which that ran, like, this was the rebel insurgency attacking the fortress. And in this movie, and listen, certainly there is examination on the personalities that ran through this. And I certainly don't doubt that Marley Mapes in that very, very moment was hurt by nasty things that people were writing on that blog. But this movie makes it plays it as if it is happening now. And it plays what we believe a toxic internet comment culture, which I don't think, you know, is very controversial of a statement at this point in 2016, was what it was then. So they play it both ways. On one hand, it's like, what are blogs? On the other hand, it's like, no, all these people, they hate me, in a way that I found a little incongruous to our modern timeline. But go ahead and check it out. Truth. I will say Robert Redford, man, national treasure. I love that guy.
I he was great in Captain America 2.
Yeah.
That was awesome to see him in that kind of role. I have a pick, and I've been working on a I can't listen to like things that are spoken word or anything like that. I have to listen to music. But if I'm like doing computer coding or things like that, as I've been doing for a project the last few days, I watch a lot of TV and stuff, a lot of stuff. And I'll do this pick now because another one for after things. We'll do an abbreviated version of that. But my pick is it's on Netflix right now. It's a show that it's one of these shows that it gets the format, gets the genre. And it's a delightful, fun little show. It's silly, and it's so, I guess, trying to be in the zeitgeist of what you would consider PC or whatever. But it's Supergirl. I mean, been watching that show, and it's been a fun show. It's fun to see where TV's evolved to the point of view where you can do a show with really good special effects for television, et cetera. And the cast is very likable. Calista Flockhart's character, who initially I'm like, this is going to be frustrating, but it's become much more of a developed personality than the whole, the Devil Wears Prada sort of archetype you thought she was going to be. And I think it's a particular kind of show like Arrow and those other sorts of DC comic character things on CW, which is where Supergirl is now. It just fun trope, really likable cast, So that's been the show I've been watching and just enjoying kind of more as I do something else, just have it kind of playing.
Yeah,
it's predictable. I mean, it's.
We've talked about over on Cord Killers about how as much as DC keeps agonizing hardcore fans on the movie side, they're killing it on the TV side.
I like the show, but I wouldn't compare it anywhere near like Daredevil or anything like that.
But they're doing a different angle than Marvel has. Like, it seems to be more joyful and wearing its comic bookiness camp on its sleeve and stuff.
I would say in the TV, if we're including Netflix, I think Marvel's the leader there. If we're talking broadcast or whatever, then CW, because I ain't even going to talk about S.H.I.E.L.D. I think they're like my dad and my brother watch Arrow. They really dig it. I've been watching The Flash. I dig The Flash, and I think the Supergirl kind of thing, it's there's certain cliches that they have in there that I don't think they even really are conscious that they're doing that are kind of funny. It's like, well, here's this predictable thing that's going to happen. It's kind of like how Doctor Who, you watch a Doctor Who episode. I'm like, oh, okay. This is gonna be an episode in the last seven minute mark before its end. He reveals that he knew all along that the bad guy was up to this, and it's gonna reverse it, and we're gonna get a big long speech, but it's still fun. So
yeah, and I think that's the key is just they seem to have cornered their market on fun, that's something that they do well, and thank God, because that's. Number one, the point of comics is the large palette of storytelling options that you have in a very rapid installment kind of platform. So I'm glad that if you are going to translate that to a medium like television, that for every, dark noir kind of, Daredevil or Jessica Jones or blaxploitation Luke Cage, that you just get a big, super colorful, loud, fun series like Arrow and Supergirl.
One of the things I really love what they're doing too is I love how they'll go back and Supergirl's her Earth parents are played by Dean Cain and Helen Slater, so the guy that played Superman and Lois and Clark, and then Helen Slater who played the original Supergirl, so making her the parents in the Flash was it John Wesley Shipp plays the Flash's father and stuff. I dig that, initially sort of stunt casting, but it's sort of a habit for them to say hey, let's get people who've already been in these franchises and let's kind of recast them, put them in other roles there or closer to it. I think and they did that again. I guess they did that with Smallville too.
Christopher Reeve would show up in there. It's a great way to ensure that, that there's a lot of heart, because those are people who had previously held the mantle and now they get to be a part of, the next chapter of that franchise.
Yeah. Well, in Smallville his mother was, originally was the
Lana Lang
whatever, from the original. Yeah. The series too, which was cool, but yeah, it's a neat thing. Gentlemen.
Yo.
Let's say it's been weird.
Yeah.
It has been weird.
It has been weird.
What's our target for after things?
Well, we just do hit it really quick. We got a question, and then I got a little topic-y thing to go into. Let me go into I'll do a. I have a really quick tip for people how to create ebooks if we want to do that.
Cool.
Found a really super easy way to do that. So
I'm gonna go pee pee in the potty.
Right. Yeah, and let us know everything else, Brian, because I'm curious about your process now. Have I been doing it wrong?
All right. Hey, people. Welcome to the Between Things. I've been working on new music stuff, and I just sent off one of the songs that I've been working on to a gentleman, the guy who actually mastered my last album, Mercury Counter. He does like consultations and stuff, and so I was like, hey, you know, can you? I sent it off to like I don't know it's the kind of thing that I would want to get like fully mastered, so I was just like, hey, can you just like send me some? He'll do this. He'll send you like feedback on like, hey, like what's up with my mix or what do you think of this arrangement? And so. So I'm kind of on pins and needles a little bit of just like, I don't know. It's just, I've been listening to it a lot lately because I've been trying to get the mix down on the song. And now I'm like, I'm getting used to it and I'm starting to not like it. And I think part of it is because it's a very complicated song compared to like other stuff I've put out this past year or so, which have been like really simple things that I like. I would literally make them on Twitch and then submit them to iTunes on the stream. So I wouldn't like spend this much time trying to like make the mix super nice, but this thing is so complicated and multifaceted that I want it to sound good, but I don't know.
Let me ask you a question, Bryce.
Sure.
I've been working on a project for Author Page to make it very, very easy for people to like sell books, like a simpler, like, how to like create a link, whatever, without having to create a bunch of different accounts, like kind of just literally go to a page, create your link to do this, and then you just authorize your account to whatever you want to do. Mm-hmm. Is that a thing that has application, let's say like in music and selling individual tracks and stuff, where you get like a higher percentage and all that?
Like you mean like a referral code?
Like if you had, let's say, a track you wanted to sell and you wanted to have a link, like click here to buy it.
Sure. You'd
be able to do like a payout within like 24 hours.
Do you mean like an entire selling process or like a link to the iTunes purchase page?
No, a whole selling process, end to end. We'll talk later.
Okay, I feel like Bandcamp is probably the solution to that, or is like already filling a super quick niche of like getting it on very quick and selling it.
That's good. I want to look at that because I want to see how that would apply for ebook publishing. Yeah.
Because they do. Bandcamp has been doing this for a while, so they've kind of figured it out in terms of like incorporating merchandise and digital goods, mm-hmm, and tour dates and stuff, and I think you can buy tickets and stuff. So in terms of music, they have sort of nailed that.
That's cool. What's their percentages?
I think it's about 30%, which is what you would normally get, or what they would normally take from all the other stores.
No, that sounds very cool. No, this is good. This is a good model to look at what's working for there. Yeah.
If you're looking for some, another similar thing is DistroKid, which is what I use to get on the stores. Mm-hmm. And they're like a very automated process in terms of.
Wait, should this be content?
Oh. No, when it's a little more further developed.
Oh, content? Probably. Content? Did somebody say content?
But you should look at that. That's. An automated.
Yeah, no, I mean, but these aren't one click. These are a go create account, do all that stuff. But that's good. I mean, it's good to know what's that serving that part of the market right now. And that's been trying to figure out how do you streamline that process entirely?
Sure. Well, remind me about it, because the way DistroKid does it, it's kind of a one click thing on the inside, but that's a different.
Yeah, but that's been the big kind of like for publishing all this stuff. The problem has just been the whole. How do you get it rolling or get it going, which is a big problem about publishing. But anyway, we can, gotcha. We'll talk later.
Yeah.
Very cool. Gentlemen.
Oh. I think he had a little bit more pee-pee.
And DistroKid is a monthly fee.
Yeah, but DistroKid doesn't charge per release and per track subscription fees, which every other site does, and they can do it because it's all automated.
Mm-hmm.
What am I looking for?
Oh, And it's a monthly payout. Gotcha.
Alrighty, I think I'm ready, if you guys are.
I'm ready.
I'm ready. I'm ready.
Okay, take it away in 3, 2.
Welcome to the After Things podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Justin Robert Young.
Yo, it's after. My name is Justin.
And Brian Brushwood.
It's true. His name is Justin.
So, man, this brings me the soundtrack for Bring It On. Not that I've watched that movie endlessly over and over again, because that would just be weird.
Jeez, man. First Supergirl, then Bring It. We'll probably Bring It On first before Supergirl.
Don't know what you're talking about. So, listen, gentlemen. First, I have a little minor announcement I want to say. I didn't say this on Weird Things, but it was just came out in Publishers Marketplace. Now I can talk about it. I have, in March, my new Jessica Blackwood book comes out from HarperCollins, and I've just signed a new book deal with Thomas and Mercer, which is one of the Amazon publishing companies, a division of Amazon, and I will have a book out in November. The Naturalist will be coming out.
Ah, there we go. Congratulations. I think that is a perfect place for you and your writing. I think that you will synergize very, very well with them.
This is tell me a bit about the publisher.
Thomas, so Amazon has their own publishing imprints. They have Thomas and Mercer is one of them that does their thriller and mystery imprints. So they're going to be releasing my book Naturalist, which they do print copies and they do the digital and all that. So it'll be my first release with their publishing arm.
Man, that's great. How cool.
Yeah, I had a wonderful conversation with a couple of their art writers who've been with it, and they've been very, very happy. And they're like me, they're hybrid. And so still with HarperCollins, so I do my Jessica Blackwood series there, and I can launch this series over there. Because I've always wanted to have multiple book series going on simultaneously. So that's going to be an exciting year for me for 2017, is to have the two books back to back. And a little later on, I'm going to talk about just a really cool trick I learned for doing quick ebook publishing. But first
what
up.
Weird trick. That simplifies ebook publishing.
One weird trick. So we had a question came in, and this is funny because Bryce sent it to me. He's like, do you want to answer this personally or on the show? I'm like, no, this is a good question for the show, even though it's coming from somebody whose name is, quote, Rick Trollins. So
seems legit.
If that's your real name, it's an awesome name. And he writes, I'm a longtime fan of Weird After Things, and last week seemed like a contradiction. Andrew Main mentions people asking him questions on social media about his, all caps, expertise on Mars. I do not want my expertise on Mars is, so, and especially not worthy of all caps, instead of asking him. He mentions people asking questions on social media about his expertise on Mars. Instead of asking him, they should use Google to find answers for themselves, period. This is where I find a problem. People write to After Things with expertise or opinion, so instead of asking experts, we should just Google our answers, right? I'm not sure if I get which way the question is going, but I have an opinion either way.
Well, it sounds to him like he's saying asking a celebrity host a question about Mars when it's in the time it takes to ask that question, you could just as easily Google the answer. And I think that is what's happening is what you want is not – the end goal is not to get the answer of how long the Martian day is. The end goal is to take a trusted host that you enjoy and possibly have an interaction for them. You know, it's like by that, because otherwise it becomes like while you're at a party, why bother to have small talk? You know, you want to ask me about the weather? Why are you talking to me about the weather? You can't just Google the weather and know what the temperature was like or what the traffic was like on the way over. It's like, I'm not asking about your ride up because I care how the traffic on the 405 was. I'm asking because I want to have something to talk to you about.
Yeah. And I think it comes into there's certainly different kinds of questions too. And I think, cause now I remember sort of what I talked about where sometimes people are asking stuff. It's like, I just Google that. Cause it's more like I like to talk to people about stuff where I have a take on it. You know, but if it's like, what's the length of a Martian day? Like, yeah, just ask Google that. It'll give you a better answer than I will off the top of my head. You know, and I think there's some questions where like, what's your opinion on how we like, oh, we'll do this. And so I think sometimes it's you get questions. And you're like, man, like, I'm happy to have an exchange, but I can't offer you anything in that exchange other than nowhere near as accurate as what Google would be. But then some questions, though, there are some questions that aren't easily Google. People don't know how to frame them because we don't have context. And I try to understand that, too, because I know a lot of times people are like, I don't even know how to phrase this. I find this all the time. Like, if I'm trying to code something, like, I don't even know how to do what I need to do. And I got to spend 10 minutes just figuring out how to ask the question to do the thing. And I think that it's you know, we all believe in like the idea that you should, you know, you have to weigh arguments from authority and understand what authority, what their domains really are, what they're not. I'm a former cruise ship magician, you know, and I have opinions about stuff, and I'll tell you where my opinions are based on. But some things I'm happy to weigh in on and go, oh, I think this is cool, or there's a more complicated answer to this than what you will find in a quick search.
Well, I think that's been, and it's taken me a while to get to that point with online comments and dealing with people, but I think I've realized that so much of what people are asking is not really what they're asking. There's like a question behind the question. You know, when somebody emails me at brian@schwood.com, which I give out at the end of every Scam School episode, and they say, hey, could you give me a shout out on your channel? They're not really saying, I need, because that would be really weird. But what they're really saying is, I value your content, and it would make me feel real special if I had any kind of interaction with you at all. And, you know, when people call the toll-free number and then they get through the Byzantine maze to my cell phone, and they, you know, they just make up the dumbest question on the spot because they don't care about the question. What they care about is, oh, I'm having what feels like a conversation with somebody who I like a lot. And, you know, once I knew that, it became so much easier to have those conversations, to just sort of like say like a shout out on the channel. Oh, man, I wish I could give a shout out to everyone. Glad you liked the show. What's your favorite episode? And then it's like, all right, I got to go. Bye. You know, it gets a lot easier. And so I would say don't be offended when people ask dumb stuff, although I am guilty of using let me Google that for you from time to time. Have you ever done that?
I wouldn't feel I've maybe done that once to like a friend just to be mean because it's a mean thing to do.
I've done it and then I've hidden you could even hide it so it doesn't show as an LMGTFY. But yeah,
I like, and I guess my point is that, and I because I'll get questions and people like Tekla's like, I'm going to look it up. I'm like, a lot of times, like, I'm going to check this before I answer you. I'm going to try to check to make sure my facts are straight because I'm a guy that, like, I'm big on abstract theory. When it comes to hard data and stuff like that, you know, I tend to try to wing it. And so I try, like, I'm going for my book, How to Make Money on Mars. Like, I spent today, like, putting in a bunch of references and stuff because it's like somebody gets to the end of a chapter, like, oh, where can I read more on this? It's like, well, a lot of it is stuff that, like, you know, over the years, you just sort of like, you know, these sorts of things, but let me give you some sources to find stuff that's more information on it. You know,
there is one type of request that it's like, it's a bummer because it's super tedious and a pain in the butt for me. And it's a very inefficient way to do it. But I would say in the entire universe, I'm pretty much the world's foremost expert on remembering what tricks I did on Scam School. And so with like, you can't Google it, you can't find it. People will be like, there was a $20 bill and it ended up in a register and there was a corner torn off. And I'm like, oh yeah. Do. And so like weirdly, I feel like that's a service that I can offer. Please don't ask me. Everyone.
I have so little recollection of like people will be like, hey, I love that. I do this such and such trick. That's great. I'm like, thank you for that. I'm like, oh yeah. You know, that was a thing I made up in 2006.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, I'm very divorced from my past. I am like, I have really, really horrible memory, really horrible personal, like biographical memory.
I've been thinking about whether I should feel bad about that because I'm the same way.
I forgot to.
no, but I'm the same way where it's just like There's so much I don't remember, or just because I don't hold it, I'm just not interested in that. And you hear about somebody like Pendulette, who, you know, keeps a journal and reviews the last 10 years and you know, remembers all that stuff, and as a result has a lot better recall. You know, whereas meanwhile, Justin and I rediscovered the whole bit of the all set up magician. And then Bryce had to point out that we spent 30 minutes developing the bit a year ago. And we were like, oh, yeah, did we? It was funny then, too, right?
Yeah. Moving forward. I mean, it's like, yeah, I'm always just worried on what's next. But probably wouldn't be a bad habit to, I don't know, I'd start a journal and it'd probably depress me.
You know, I think for me, certainly my calendar was like that, or maybe going like going through when I was touring really heavily, I would just see the name of the school and the flights I was taking. And it's like, I would be able to remember all that stuff. What's that?
And start to cry.
Yeah. I once performed Treasure Valley Community College.
So I have we'll keep this a short episode, but I have a really cool tip. I get this question a lot, like, how do I create an ebook, like an EPUB format? Mm-hmm. I swear I didn't just stutter. How do I create an EPUB or an ebook? How do I do that? And trying to round trip, that's not always been very, very easy. Now I've got one simple trick for creating an EPUB. And I called up my buddy Peter Wax last night, like, cause he's been working on a project. I'm like, dude, like, my favorite thing for finishing stuff and is using Vellum, because it makes very pretty ebooks, but it doesn't do footnotes and hyperlinks and stuff, which is problematic. But if you don't need those, Vellum's great if you're on the Mac to do that. But if you want to just create a dirt simple way to produce an EPUB now, Google Docs. You can go inside of Google Docs, kick your Google document, go in and use the heading. Like, you go in, let's say each chapter, use like the heading to create a heading, and that'll create insert a table of contents. It'll create a table of contents. It'll format it for EPUB that you can then open in iBooks. You can import it for Kindle, and you can do all those other formats. You can create everything inside of a Google Doc now to do an EPUB.
That's awesome. I wouldn't have expected that to work so easy, but I guess EPUB, it doesn't format it super pretty the way Vellum does though, huh?
Vellum does really nice, like, chapter headings and fonts and stuff. And so Vellum's got that nice little touch to it. So it's the trade-off. Like, I'll be doing my Mars book in Vellum. You know, I'm going to do that in Vellum because Vellum allows me, like, I like that. But I would consider if I, you know, kind of like in retrospect, it's like, yeah, if I needed to make it a little bit more of a, you know, a lot more footnotes and hyperlinks and stuff like that, knowing that going forward, it's like, okay, there might be situations. But if you just want a really easy way, if you're writing short stories or books or whatever, and you just want an easy way to produce an ebook, you can go on Google Docs, you can create the book that you need from there, a table of contents, all that. You can go upload it onto Amazon system with, you know, images, whatever you need to do. So, you know, the other services will let you sell it, Google Play. So it's a much more simple way to do it. And that's just, there was just this year they added the format for EPUB.
That's awesome. That's very cool.
Did Bryce, like, create one as I said this?
Well, he pulled up the Night Attack Diamond Club never-ending novel, Murderito.
Which Andrew helped, along with Peter J. Wax, I believe, helped begin, right?
That's right.
Yeah, that's right. That's
right. Wow, that dovetails really perfectly into our conversation about how nobody remembers more than 5 seconds into the past.
Jeez. Telling you, like mayflies.
I mean, I really look forward to the internet telling me what my life was like. Like,
no, I'll tell you what, that's actually brilliant, Andrew. I'm really glad that you shared that, because I know, as somebody who only really deigns to do an ebook, you know, whenever he's, you know, just periodically wants to write absolute nonsense, it always is the worst and most, like, temperamental part of things. And so if you're doing something simple, especially because, I'm sure it's better now, but, like, you know, with a lot of those, like, e-ink Kindles, things kind of format in different ways anyway, mm-hmm. when you're reading it. So it's like, if you just want something dirt, dumb, simple, the fact that Google Docs does it is great.
Well, and I don't know, it's really a testament to, there's a million excuses you can have come up with to stop or to keep yourself from doing something. But nowadays, that separation is like, at some point you got to put the blame on yourself and be like, oh, it's not because I haven't found a publisher or an agent or because I don't have the tools to blah, blah, blah. It's because I just haven't done it because now you could just open up a free software, publish for free, and get it out.
Yeah, and you can even take – you could take a document. You could go into Word – or excuse me, Microsoft Word's not what I meant to say. You could go into Google Docs, and you could create a document, and then you could say, hey, Brian, could you go in and take a look at my book and edit it? And you could make notes in that document, and then I can create – from those notes, I can then improve it or do whatever I want to, and then click Output. I can create an EPUB from there, right? And then I can put that EPUB in my Google Drive and share it with people. And if I wanted to do a new version of the book, I can actually replace that same EPUB URL with the new version.
Yeah.
So very, very helpful. But let's you guys got to get ready for Night Attacks. Let's jump into picks.
Yeah, I'm going to do a really silly one. I played it for free this afternoon. We're probably going to play it again in the after show. But from Squanchtendo, Justin Roiland's production company, and Crows comes a free VR game called Accounting. And it's the first game I'm getting for the Vive that I'm going to have to explain to my children. They're just not allowed to play because there's some dark themes in there and a hell of a lot of salty language. It's pretty funny, though, because I feel bad that I went through it as fast as I did because the puzzles are trivial. And the real star of the show is just the long form, just continuous improvisation that people just keep on going. You know, there's these scripted chatter events just to kind of keep stuff afloat while they're waiting for you to solve the puzzle. But the talent for improvisation these guys have, just they keep on going and going and going and going. And it was a lot of fun, and it's free. Maybe a 20 or 30 minute experience, but I laughed out loud. It was great.
I love that he called it Squanchtendo.
Yeah.
Yeah. My pick is I watched Star Wars again on the plane. I really liked Star Wars Episode 7. I was unprepared for how much I would be charmed by it. I really, really, really liked it. So go watch it again.
I have a pick. And I spent this weekend when I was trying to like take a break, walk away from my computer and do something else, like just lay on my bed and watch something. I watched all of the behind the scenes stuff for the re-release of Aliens, James Cameron's take on the Ridley Scott film Alien, his follow up to that. The original Alien was a script by Danny O'Bannon, and Ridley Scott did a wonderful job. So James Cameron steps on board to do Aliens. And what's neat about this is you have to understand that this is sort of James Cameron went from being a guy that was doing set dressing and props and stuff for Roger Corman science fiction flicks to just a couple years later, he did Terminator. And the same time he was working on that, he gets offered to do Terminator production got pushed back. So he thought he was going to be able to shoot it, but then they had to wait because Arnold Schwarzenegger was under contract. So he couldn't get Arnold then. He needed money and he got hired to do the Rambo First Blood Part 2 script. And then he was offered by offhand, like, would you be interested in writing a script for Aliens? Not direct, but just write the script for Aliens. And as James Cameron describes it, he took, you know, every bit of control that it took to not burst out and say yes and say, you know, like, yeah, I'd be interested in that. And he had been a huge fan of that. It was, you know, Ridley Scott was influenced in the same way James Cameron was when Star Wars came out, because the first Star Wars film, you had the Millennium Falcon with rust stains, you know, was a lived in universe where our prior, you know, space movies like 2001, everything was NASA gleaming shiny. And here was this dirty sort of things were broken. And Alien got pushed into production off the success of Star Wars. And Ridley Scott did an amazing, amazing film. You go back and watch Alien and the production design there. It's incredible. And here comes James Cameron, who's asked to do the sequel. And as we all know, sequels suck. Yeah, that was historically sort of the point of view, but it's not really true. Godfather 2 is great. And
But also what was remarkable about Aliens is sequels were always just the first movie made again. Yep. And they did something very, very different. They told a war story in Aliens. There were horror elements, but nothing like the psychological terror of the Predator and Prey story of the first movie.
Absolutely. And that was what Cameron was very wise. He went and said, I'm going to take a different path here. He'd sold the producers on the idea of, I'm going to make this a war movie. It's going to be, you know, be Aliens, war movie. They're like, we love it. And he put together a great script, and he wasn't going to be able to direct it until they saw Terminator. And they saw Terminator and said, all right, this guy gets to direct it. Production of the movie, they shot it in England. It was problematic. James Cameron's James Cameron working with the British crew. You can only imagine how those two got along or did not get along. The behind the scenes stuff is just amazing. And you watch, you see how meticulous he is about every single point, every single thing. You get a deep appreciation. And this, you're watching this guy, and you know, he's making this movie in 1984, 1985. And to see that later on he would create, you know, his own billion-dollar franchise and Avatar, et cetera, everything else, it's not that surprising given how hardworking and how thoughtful he was about everything. So the Aliens behind the scenes stuff, I highly recommend. The Alien as well, you know, which is, Alien was just this out of nowhere. Ridley Scott, you know, the guy who did the movie The Duelist, you know, gets picked to do a science fiction film when people are like, Ridley Scott? And well, yeah, hell yeah, it was a brilliant choice. So
that's awesome.
My picks.
Awesome.
It's been after.
Boom.
Hey, hey, good show, guys.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, Bryce, what do you say me and you mm-hmm. coordinate what Skype to roll back to?
Sure. Let me. Oh, okay. Bye, Andrew.
Hey, why don't we actually let's drop the stream for a little bit.
Yeah, and, that's exactly. I was going to say. Yeah. I'll call you in a minute, Just.
You got it.
Okay. If you're watching live,
we're stick around, Justin, because once the stream's off, I got to check something with you.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, if you're watching the stream, stick around. Night Attack will probably start
15?
Probably a little late.
15:20? 15:20.
Bye, guys.